Do you have trouble taking Apush notes?
Yeah, I do.
Do you forget everything you write down after you're writing it?
Yeah.
Well, we're here to help.
Really?
Introducing the Apush Guide to All Things Forgettable.
That's a lot of things.
Don't believe us? Order a free trial today for a Chapter 19 sample. $19.95 for shipping and handling. Call 1-800-REMEMBER-THINGS-NOW.
Hi, I'd like to order one of those Apush Guide things. Yeah, just one. The free one. Thanks.
Introducing the Apush Guide to All Things Forgettable, Chapter 19 Edition. Special thanks to our three historians, Carol Waldo, Kevlin Sweenmeister, and Eleanor Swanson. Section 1, Forgettable Presidents.
Course of AP US history, students learn all of the presidents of the United States. However, actually retaining the information about each one of the 44 presidents we've had so far and what occurred during their terms proves challenging for even the brightest AP students. But there is a string composed of a select few underachiever presidents that are nearly impossible to remember, who served between the years 1877 and 1897. The first president to be overlooked by history and AP students alike is Rutherford B. Hayes. The 19th president of the United States did not start his term smoothly. In fact, his election as president is even questionable considering the fact that Congress practically gave him any doubted votes in the Electoral College in 1877. The most important action Mr. B. Hayes took during his presidential term was basically to cinch the end of the Reconstruction era by removing military presence and influence within Southern affairs. Rutherford even appointed a Southern Democrat into his own cabinet. Historians can only suggest reasons as to why this president is overlooked, considering his proactive policies that finalized the Reconstruction era and brought the Union back together. Unfortunately, his legacy, as well as the first name Rutherford, have disappeared into oblivion. Arguably one of the most forgettable and irrelevant presidents of the history of the United States was James A. Garfield. Elected as the 20th president of the United States in 1881, Garfield's term in office was short-lived because he was assassinated at a railroad station in Massachusetts. One of the few actions Garfield took during his short term was firing many government workers when he came into office, for fear they would take his brain, flesh, and blood. And ironically, in the end, they succeeded when he was fatally shot. Because the 20th president of the United States was executed, Garfield's vice president, Chester A. Arthur, became the 21st president in 1881 by default. Arthur is most famously remembered for his exquisite wardrobe and the remodeling he did to the White House, rather than the policies themselves. Concerning political matters, Arthur supported civil service reform and signed the Pendleton Act, which set up civil service commission and began awarding people government positions based on merit rather than money. He also vetoed two bills. The first bill he vetoed allowed federal funding to go towards harbors and rivers, and the second bill that he vetoed was excluding the Chinese as immigrants into the United States during the Gold Rush era. These vetoes put him at odds with the Republican Party, and he never really received another nomination after his first presidential term had ended. Perhaps it was because they were just jealous of his mutton chops.
What are mutton chops?
This next unadored president was unique in that he is the only president to ever serve a split term in the United States, being both the 22nd and 24th president. Who is this mystery man, you ask? Why, it's Grover Cleveland, of course. Cleveland broke a long Republican reign when he was elected as a Democrat for his first term from 1885 to 1889, and his second term, which lasted from 1893 to 1897. Cleveland believed that it was not the government's responsibility to help with relief programs, and he also managed to end the Pullman strike by using military intervention. Along with the brute actions Cleveland took during his presidency, Grover was also somewhat of a playa in modern-day terminology, and stirred a lot of controversy during his terms by fathering an illegitimate child and then going on to marry a 21-year-old female when he himself was a 48-year-old man.
Ugh.
This next one's my favorite. The last of the easily forgotten presidents in the United States history was Benjamin Harrison. He was elected in 1889 and served till 1893 as the 23rd president of the United States. Benjamin Harrison was the grandson of former president William Henry Harrison, and piggybacked on his grandfather's successful political career by using the popular campaign slogan, "Grandfather's hat fits Ben." During Harrison's presidency, he passed the Sherman Antitrust Act of 1890, which outlawed trusts and monopolies that hindered trade. He also passed the Sherman Silver Purchase Act, which increased the amount of purchasable silver. The McKinley Tariff Act he passed protected American manufacturers, and the Dependent Pension Bill, another one that he passed, broadened the qualifications of pension for Civil War veterans who were unable to do manual labor. During his term, he also began to form a two-ocean navy, which was revolutionary for the time. And he also joined the first Pan-American Conference that took place in 1889. Harrison also called for the American flag to be flown at every public school. Along with his epic patriotism, six states also joined the Union during his presidency. Although Harrison had a very productive four-year term, Benjamin could never fully come out of his grandfather's very large shadow, which is why he's practically irrelevant today. Interestingly enough, one may have observed throughout this whole video that each and every one of these forgettable presidents has significant and unique amounts of facial hair. Whether or not there is actually a direct correlation between the boringness of presidents and their facial hair is up to the scientists to decide. But as for me, a historian, I have fulfilled my obligations, and hopefully now you will remember these horribly uninteresting presidents. I know I won't.
Section 2, the election of 1896.
I'm here to teach y'all about the election of 1896, the election that ended the era of forgettable presidents. The Democrats and Republicans obviously had opposite platforms for this election. The Democrats won only a limited silver coinage at the traditional ratio of 16 ounces of silver to 1 ounce of gold. However, this unlimited coinage would cause inflation. Kind of like me after Thanksgiving dinner, am I right? The Republicans supported the gold standard and proposed a high tariff that would protect industries. At the beginning of the election, there were two clear frontrunners, William McKinley for the Republican Party and William Jennings Bryan for the Democratic candidate. McKinley was a Jeb Bush of sorts in this election, as he received a ton of money from outside sources, while Bryan traveled the country giving some 600 speeches. Talk about a man with a lot to say, am I right? Anyway, he received a lot of support from farmers and debtors who were convinced that the unlimited silver coinage would be the best option. McKinley's supporters with the cash helped him greatly throughout the election, as in they practically did all the work. His right-hand man, or should I say his rich-hand man, Marcus Hanna did most of the campaigning for McKinley. He raised tons of money from businessmen threatened by the inflation from the silver lunacy. Hanna used this money to put McKinley into magazines and newspapers. Even with his hard work and many miles traveled, the final weeks of the election really hurt Bryan's popularity. There was a rise in wheat prices, which made farmers less desperate, which kind of sucked because the majority of Bryan's supporters were farmers. Also, employers told workers that the factories would shut down if Bryan was elected, as the Democrats' silver policy was very harmful to many businesses. To no one's surprise, William McKinley won the election and became the 25th President of the United States. This election ended the stalemate of politics in the Gilded Age, and the defeat of Bryan started an era of Republican-dominated presidencies. The populist parties declined, and the election was a victory for big businesses, urban centers, conservative economics, and middle-class values. McKinley emerged as the first modern president, and the country became a superpower in foreign affairs.
What a freak.
Section 3, The Growth of Discontent.
Hello, I'm here to teach you about the growth of discontent between the years 1888 to 1896. Basically, it was a period of time where no one was happy. I feel a deep connection to this time period because I, too, suffer from an emotional and financial depression. I don't get paid enough for this job.
How pathetic.
Anyways, back to the subject at hand. During this time, there were two elections. In the first one, Harrison, along with the Republican Party, ran against Cleveland and the Democratic Party. Cleveland won the popular vote, but Harrison won in the Electoral College and became the president, upsetting many. Harrison supported high tariffs during a difficult time within the economy.
The growth of discontent can be explained using chocolate chip cookies. People wanted to build railroads / bake chocolate cookies. But there wasn't enough money to build railroads, or enough chocolate to make fully chocolate cookies. This led to overbuilding / overbaking. People became poor and angry that they didn't have money / chocolate chips. The chocolate chips in the cookies represent how wealth during this time period was concentrated in certain areas and not spread equally among the people.
Angry farmers formed the Farmers Alliance, which led to the formation of the Populist Party. Members of this party met in Omaha, Nebraska, to finalize their platform and select candidates for the next election. Populists wanted many changes, including direct election of senators, citizens able to directly vote on proposed laws, increase of money supplies with unlimited silver coins, taxes based on a person's income, the higher the income, the more the tax, railroads owned publicly by the government, government-owned telegraph and telephone systems, federal warehouses and loans for farmers to help stabilize the price of crops, and an 8-hour workday. The populists lost in the 1892 election. Cleveland and Harrison once again faced each other. Cleveland won due to the people being tired of Harrison's support of the McKinley Tariff of 1890, a tariff that raised tax on foreign products. After the election, a long depression, similar to mine, entered the country. Overspeculation and overbuilding of railroads caused the stock market to crash, and the Panic of 1893 began. Cleveland became conservative and did not do much to aid the economy. Unemployment reached up to 20% of the workforce. Hobos and people who relied on soup kitchens increased across the country. Due to a drop on the gold reserve, Cleveland repealed the Sherman Silver Purchase Act of 1890. This act had increased the coinage of silver, but taking it away did little to help the drain of gold. To support the dollar and gold standard, Cleveland borrowed $6.5 million from J.P. Morgan, a Wall Street banker. Because of this, people thought the government was only an aid for rich bankers from the East. Cleveland's use of military force to end the Pullman strike also angered Americans. The only popular tariff passed was the Wilson-Gorman tariff in 1894. It reduced tariffs and increased the tax on people who had an income of over $2,000 a year. Only people with high incomes were taxed. Sadly, within the year, the Supreme Court said the tax was unconstitutional and shut it down. Cut. In 1894, populist Jacob A. Coxey from Ohio led a march to Washington. Coxey's army wanted the government to spend $500 million on public works to create jobs. All the lead protesters were arrested and the march fell apart. The government really knows how to listen to the people. Coins Financial School by William H. Harvey told America that problems were being caused by rich, corrupt bankers. Harvey said that the only way to restore the economy was to coin unlimited silver quantities. Not a great idea, but at least he was trying to help. Overall, the growth of discontent can be summed up as a period of time where people were poor, hungry, and angry at the government. All three moods similar to mine.
Same.
And that concludes the Apush Guide to All Things Forgettable, Chapter 19 Edition. I hope, now, you remember. And if not, you might want to switch out.
I understand! What? This is Apush Guide to All Things Forgettable.
No way!